gentlemen, announcing the arrival of Yang Amat Berbahagia, Tun Dr. Mahathir Mohamad and Tun Dr. Siti Hasmah Muhammad Ali.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Firstly, I would like to say thank you for this opportunity to speak to this forum organized by the Mahathir Global Peace School. I feel a little bit shy of mentioning, associating peace with me, because sometimes people don't think I'm a very peaceful person. But anyway, I would like to say this about this program. For PEPF, the association, the collaboration that we established with Muhammadiyah Movement in Indonesia is one giant step in our effort to spread the views that war is a crime. The Muhammadiyah organization is really a very big organization in Indonesia, and they have espoused this cause much more than in other countries, unfortunately. But we will try in other countries as well. So I would like to say a big thank you to the Muhammadiyah Movement and the University Muhammadiyah Yogyakarta. Now, peace is something that is desired by everyone. No one likes war. War is very disabling, terrible in terms of the cost in lives and property. And everybody, we can see today, is running away from war. We see a lot of people from the war-torn areas in Western Asia, in Syria, for example, leaving their Muslim country to seek for a better life in a country that does not espouse Islam. That is something to me very shameful, because we Muslims have not been able to govern our countries in peace and stability, to the point where our people, Muslim people, are running away from Muslim countries to non-Muslim countries. I think we should think deeply about this. And part of the reason why this is happening is because there are wars in our countries. Wars which are so devastating that you see whole countries destroyed and thousands of people killed. Many, many had to leave their country to live in neighboring countries. We see millions of migrants today leaving Syria and other war-torn areas to live in Turkey, Lebanon, Jordan and other neighboring countries. And today there is this phenomenon in Europe where the European countries are very reluctant to accept migrants from these countries where the people are usually Muslim. So that is what is happening today, and it is caused by war. People want peace, they don't want war. You know that among Muslims, the greeting is through saying, "Peace be upon you. Salam alaikum." And strangely, the Jews also greet each other with the word shalom. Shalom means peace. That is the extent of their desire for peace since ancient times. But unfortunately, they have not been able to achieve peace. Why is it that they are not able to achieve peace? The reason is very simple. It is because we regard war as an instrument for the settlement of conflicts between nations. In the old days, between tribes. But in the old days, ancient times, people were primitive. They knew of no other way to settle conflicts between them other than by fighting each other, other than by going to war and killing each other. But today we say we are civilized. We claim to be very civilized. Today we object to people who do not have freedom of speech, freedom of the press, etc. These are so great value that we uphold it to the point where we are prepared to destabilize countries which do not practice this freedom. But we still believe in killing people in order to settle our conflict. You and I know that killing is a crime. You kill a person, you may be charged with murder, and maybe you would be tried and found guilty and hanged. But the Europeans today talk about capital punishment must be abolished. They say it is inhuman to hang a person who had killed another person. Of course, in Malaysia, we still hang them. But in many of the European countries and Western countries, they have abolished capital punishment. That is the measure of the value they put on human life. That you can't kill, even if it is a killer, a murderer, you mustn't kill. It is bad. That is what they say. But on the other hand, they are quite prepared to bomb whole countries, kill hundreds of thousands of people, destroy the whole country in their effort to achieve peace. Of course, they fight wars in order to achieve peace. They fought the First World War, the Second World War, in order to stop all wars. But you know, they have not stopped all wars. They have continued to kill, and kill in a very indiscriminate way. In the good old days, the killing is done by soldiers fighting on battlefields, killing other soldiers. You have one group of soldiers on one side, another group of soldiers on the other side, and they fight and they clash, and sometimes the leaders fight. And if the leaders are killed, then the war stops. That was during the primitive times when we knew no better. We were not very humane in those days. But today, wars are no longer fought on battlefields. They are no longer fought by soldiers against other soldiers. Today, the whole country has become a battlefield. No part of the country is exempted. It doesn't matter who is living there. It may be women, children, sick people, decrepit people, OKUs, and very, very old people, or very, very young people. All these are not exempted from the killings in non-modern war. When a bomb is dropped, the bomb does not recognize a soldier, or a civilian, or a sick person, or a baby, or a mother with child. Then bombs don't recognize, rockets don't recognize these people. Yes, they have smart rockets nowadays. But how smart are they? They are not smart. They are killing a lot of civilians, non-combatants. This war is horrendous. It has no feeling of sympathy for anyone. The most important thing is to shock and awe. This is the term introduced by the Americans when they invaded Iraq. To shock and awe. To shock you and create fear in you. That is the American creed when they invaded Iraq. To shock the Iraqis and to create fear among the Iraqis so that they will surrender. But of course, they were killed first before they surrendered. They were destroyed, the country was destroyed before they surrendered. Now that shock and awe philosophy or slogan has been adopted by IS. IS is the Islamic State of Lebanon and something else. You know what they do? They also do this, they also adopted the American approach of shocking and creating fear, shock and awe. And how do they shock people? In front of TV cameras, they slaughtered people. Not just decapitated, not just chop off the head. No, they use a sharp knife, pierce through the neck, and then cut slowly. It's a horrible death that you see being committed by IS people. It shocked us. And of course, it creates fear in us. Because these people do not look for soldiers or combatants to kill anybody at all. Two Japanese were journalists, not fighting against them, were captured and slaughtered. Now we have a Chinese and a European who is due to be slaughtered in front of TV camera so as to shock the world and to create fear in the world. Because they are not going to kill the person who killed. We hang murderers because they committed a crime. They kill just about anybody to create fear. And now there is a great deal of fear, even among the most powerful military powers. Because they know that these people may just catch just about anybody, a tourist passing by, may be arrested, brought before a TV camera, slaughtered for the country to see. These are your people, we are slaughtering your people. We are going to shock you and to create fear in you. And now people are less willing to take action against IS because they fear IS. So when the Americans introduce shock and awe, this is now being copied. And I don't think the Americans like it. I don't think we like it. It is wrong. Muslims should not be doing such things. But because we still subscribe to the idea that conflicts can be settled through wars, we see these things happening. People being killed, mass killings of people through bombs and rockets. And as you know, in Japan, they dropped two atom bombs, which killed 100,000 people each. And more than that, because of radiation sickness and the rest. So you can see that modern wars are far more brutal than the wars of the past, the primitive wars. We kill indiscriminately innocent people, young, old, women, old men, all will be killed. So if we still subscribe to wars as a means of settlement of conflicts, this is what we are going to see, and this is what we are going to see on ever larger scale. Today the world is frightened of the possibility of a nuclear war. And if there is a nuclear war, the whole human race would be destroyed, would be killed, or made sick. Because we drop a bomb in one place, the wind carries these radiated particles right around the world. The wind always carries particles around the world. You know, when Krakatoa blew up, the ashes from Krakatoa went 3 times around the world. So from the bombs, nuclear bombs dropped in Hiroshima, it's not only Hiroshima which was affected, but the rest of Japan was affected, and even America became affected because of the effect on the fish and the food that they eat. So we have now the capacity to destroy the world, to destroy all of us, to kill, to destroy all our buildings and beautiful monuments, etc. That is war, modern war. That is why Perdana Global Peace Foundation regards that war is not a solution to anything, that war is a crime, that people who wage war should be arrested, put on trial, and sentenced. Maybe not sentenced to death because capital punishment is not accepted now, but they should be put in jail for the rest of their lives because their crime is terrible. Currently, we adore the people who go to war. You know, when you go to war, you win the war. You have statues erected in your honor to perpetuate the memory. You are given medals, you are given titles, and etc. We look up to people who kill people. There's something wrong with our thinking. We punish a murderer for killing one person, but we glorify a man who has killed a million people. In the last two great wars, something like 20 million people were killed. And we talk about Winston Churchill, about other people who were responsible for war also. So does Hitler and Mussolini and Toyo. These people went to war in order to solve their problem. And did they solve their problem? No, they didn't. Until now, they live in fear of war. And they have to arm themselves. And they're spending huge sums of money on killing machines. The more efficient the machine is in killing people, the more expensive they are, the more money will be spent on producing these killing machines. Today we are in the age of the unmanned aerial vehicle. I was just reading this morning about how they have produced helicopters and airplanes, big airplanes, which have no pilots, which can carry bombs and bomb people out of existence. So we may find over Kuala Lumpur a plane, and suddenly the bomb comes down, or whatever it is that they want to drop, over Kuala Lumpur, and a million or two people will be killed. And the same thing can happen to other countries. That is the prospect that we see in the future if we still believe in war as a means of settling conflict between nations. That is why the Perdana Global Peace Foundation is campaigning to make war a crime. Now, who should be punished? Not the soldiers on the field. The people who should be punished are the people who start aggressive wars, who make use of war in order to defeat their enemies. They go to war because they are strong, they can kill more people, and therefore they are very fond of going to war. Because it's not a crime. Killing a million people is a great honor. It's very glorious. But if the people who order wars to be fought, who send their armies to kill people, These people, the president or prime ministers or ministers of war or the generals, these are the people who should be arrested, put on trial, and if found guilty, they should be sentenced for a proper length of time in jail if we don't want to kill them. That is the hope of the Glama, the Kuala Lumpur Global Peace Foundation. And now we have gained support from the Muhammadiyah movement in Jakarta. And we are also trying to get the Japanese to come in, because Japan is the one country in the world that has outlawed war. Unfortunately, now they are trying to go back to using war because they are being urged by the United States to use soldiers to kill people in an effort to win wars. I hope that this movement will catch on all over the world. It will take time. We have to be patient, because if you look back on the past, on our struggle against slavery, it took 200 years before slavery was abolished. But in the end, it was abolished. It will take maybe 100 years or 200 years or maybe 10 years before we can make war a crime. But the first steps must be taken. As the Chinese philosophers say, a journey of 1,000 miles begins with the first step. We are taking the first step. And I hope that you will understand that when we say war should be made a crime, it is not about punishing soldiers. Certainly, it is not about punishing the people who had to defend themselves. It is meant for those aggressive people who make use of war in order to achieve their objective, to defeat their enemies. Inshallah, one day there'll be less war and no war, and I think we will be able to live in peace. And when we live in peace, we will all prosper and enjoy life as we should. I thank you.
All of my life I've worked to redefine war as a nonviolent means of achieving our conflicts. And my question for you, sir, is what role do you think the International Court of Justice might play in resolving our conflicts nonviolently?
Well, in order to go to the Court of Justice or the International Court of Justice, there must be agreement on the part of the pairs of countries which are having problem to agree to accept the decision of the court. In the case of Malaysia and Indonesia, Malaysia and Singapore, we all agree that we should go to the World Court and that we must accept whatever decision they make, no matter how bad it is for us. So it is the World Court which settle our problem, the problem between Indonesia and Malaysia, and the problem between Malaysia and Singapore. Of course, with Singapore, we are not happy. We still think the rock belongs to us. But the court says the rock belongs to Singapore. Very unjust. But you have already agreed to accept the decision of the World Court, and therefore you should accept even a very negative decision made by them. So the two combatants must first agree before they can go to the World Court. Just referring to the World Court, like, you know, Philippines wants the United Nations to settle its conflict with China, but China has not agreed. So it's very difficult in such cases. In such cases, we have to find some other ways. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, please welcome Bapak Dr. H. Abdul Mukti to present his lecture on justice, peace, and prosperity for global citizens, Bapak Dr. Abdul Mukti.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning. Selamat pagi. First of all, allow me to extend my sincere thanks and appreciation to BGPF for inviting me and present a very big topic under the theme Justice, Prosperity and Peace for Global Citizens. This topic is too big for me, and this forum also too big for me as well. But anyhow, before I deliver my presentation, I also express my thanks and also gratitude for the organization of this event, especially to the chairman of BGPF. Kami biasanya memanggil Bapak, Bapak Tan Sri Norian Mai, dan juga yang amat berbahagia Tun Mahathir Mohamad, walaupun beliau sudah tidak bersama kita pada kesempatan ini. And also to Rector of Universitas Muhammadiyah Yogyakarta, Profesor Bambang Cipto. And also to distinguished scholars and ladies and gentlemen. Actually, I do expect that the presentation of Dr. Mahathir would be longer, so that there is no much time for my presentation. That gives me much less a burden to speak about this, again, very big topic. But I'm very lucky because most of the theme and also the very essence of the topic related to our conference today already very well delivered and very well elaborated by Dr. Mahathir. So what I want to present now is just like what I call as the asoba, just like the residue of maybe ideas that is coming from my very humble intellectual level. Because I rather call myself as guru ngaji rather than as a scholar. So as a guru ngaji means I'd rather speak as an activist rather than as an intellectual or a professor at the university. Therefore, apologize if you may receive far below your expectation. And also, I apologize for my not very good English. It's actually one of the new colonialism when I have to speak in English, because I'm not an Englishman. The organizing committee should allow me to speak in Bahasa Indonesia and have interpreter for my presentation. But anyhow, since I have also fulfilled my responsibility to present this very big topic again, and I have consulted to Pak Rector, whatever you say, it will be very good according to Pak Rector. But it might be not good according to you. When we speak about peace, justice and prosperity, especially if we relate this to nowadays global world or globalized world, we see that we know the world has at least two realities, and some of the realities might be contradict one another. We see now the world is united, but at the same time we also see now the world is divided. We see now as the impact of globalization, there are so many divergences, but there are also convergences. We see that as the impact of globalization, there is convergence among cultures and civilization, or maybe to some extent among religions. But on the other hand, we also see the divergence. At the same time, we might see people becoming very global, But we see also the reality that people also think that need to be very strongly implementation on the locality. Instead, we can say that the world now becoming very complex, and the world now, as we can see today, also has its complexity, especially if we refer to the very important topic that we have today about justice, prosperity, and peace. Because what is going on now, and it is very observable, is the reality that we face injustice, the reality that we face inequality, and the reality that we face insecurity. What has been presented by Dr. Mahathir in his presentation today is the reality that the world is not a safer planet for us. It is the fact that people from many different, very different corner of the world face the reality that they are living under threat. Inequality also one of the serious problems. It's not only related to, for example, inequality in economy, when we see the widening gap between the rich and the poor, between the have and the not have. But we see also the reality that what we call as inequality does not only happen between countries, but it is also happen within a particular country. The super class that consists of very small people are still ruling group, and they are still a very small group that determine the future of the world. And we feel about how the world is actually work is actually very much dependent on this super class. And it's these people that determine the world policy, it is these people that determine how the culture of the world might be, let's say, engineered somehow according to the trend. So what is actually going on now is actually the world that is driven by small group, and this small group have been very powerful in many aspects of this worldly life. Therefore, if we discuss about peace, prosperity, and also justice, we need to think about the balance. Because what is going on now is a very dominant situation where certain countries have been very dominant over another. And we see the realities that even though so many countries already gained their independence, they have their political sovereignty, but in fact now we face a new form of colonialism, or as we call as neo-colonialism. It is happening not only in relation to economy, but also happen in the form of culture, but it also still happen in the form of politics. Yes, a country might have their own prime minister, a country might have their own president, but their policy, both as prime minister or president, is actually very much dependent on, or very much actually controlled by the so-called superpower. If this happening, then our expectation, our dream to have just and prosperous and peaceful world might be still very far away from the reality. So if you want to try to understand this situation, we might see the reality that the world now is again need balance of power. When we speak about balance of power, then we need a strong leadership. A strong leadership might come from, let's say, an alternative countries, which is not always coming from a big countries, but this alternative strong leadership or strong leader might come from, let's say, south countries, coming from developing countries or emerging countries. If we have this kind of strong leaders, then we might have balance. If we think about peace, then we need to have another voice, which is the voice that could give us perspective. Because what is going on now is actually the voice that coming only from one side, and others are actually totally the listeners or maybe totally the recipients. Yes, we might live in a democratic era, but we see now also the tyranny is going far away, and we see now the tyranny is part of our political reality. Yes, there is democracy, but what is going on now is not the essence of democracy, but what is going on now may be a very transactional democracy or maybe a very procedural democracy. The essence of democracy where there is respect to humanity, where there is equality and there is acceptance to pluralism is actually also far beyond our reality now. Therefore, if we want to create a just world, we need to see and empower international institutions. From the political point of view, we might need to see the existence of United Nations and some possibility to reform this United Nations, because these international institutions already used or maybe hijacked by certain countries to extend or to prolong their superiority over another. The second thing that we might need to do with regard to this peaceful coexistence and building a peaceful world to avoid war, just like Dr. Mahathir has emphasized this morning, is to have a cultural movement. We could create a peaceful world through a peaceful mind. It is these peaceful people that could very slowly but very surely contribute to the development and to the creation of peaceful world. So many things that is happening now is actually coming from the damage of inner dimension of human being. When people are becoming very greedy, and we see now the exploitation of nature, even the exploitation of humankind. This cultural movement, again, it might be something that is very luxurious in our time, because so many people see and think that the changing has to be coming from a very big power. But when we see, especially from religious perspective, we can make a change from a very simple thing and from one single person, but this changing again is coming from changing mind. If we could develop this peaceful mankind, of course education is one of the choices that we can do to produce these peaceful people, then peace might be one of the reality in our society. The second, of course, we need to have a cultural movement through dialogue. So many dialogue has been organized, and there are also so many peace organizations in many different parts. Many people criticize the more dialogue, more war. But we believe that dialogue is still one of the key aspects for the creation of peace. By dialogue, we could talk and discuss in a very peaceful mind about our problem, and we can start doing something from a very simple thing. Therefore, the establishment of peaceful dialogue, whether it is initiated at the state level or initiated by a non-government organization or by establishing a center like this that we have, is one of the strategy that we could contribute to the creation of peaceful world. The third, which is also belong to a cultural strategy or cultural movement, is by building an inclusive society where we could accept those who are different from us, we could tolerate differences, and we have the view that being inclusive, meaning being accommodative for others who are different. At the essence of this, we need to have certain kind of pluralism where we could tolerate others who are different, where we could accept and we could accommodate and even cooperate with others who are different from us. Pluralism does not mean syncretism in terms of religion, but it's come to the belief that we believe in our religion, we believe in our culture, but we do also believe that there are others who also believe in their own respective religion. We understand that we are the only one, there are others that we need to respect them, there are others that we need to accommodate them. Therefore, with this pluralistic society, pluralism is one of the key that we could accept others, we could include others instead of alienate or maybe doing any kind of, let's say, very negative social behavior such as racism and some other social pathology. And finally, when we speak about the creation of justice, prosperity and peace, there might be a political hard power, but again, this political hard power does not mean that we go to war. I agree 100% with the view of Dr. Mahathir. We cannot go to war in order to make peace, but we could have, for example, strengthening cooperation between countries. By having this, we can share prosperity, we can share our experience, and we can share our common responsibility for the creation of this peaceful planet. I think I have to stop here for my just introductory dialogue, and hopefully I could receive feedback from you all, I could receive questions from you, or maybe further explanation on this particular topic. Thank you very much.
Assalamu alaikum, sir. My name is Ahmad Hamdi, and I come from Ahmad Ibrahim College of Law. And I would like to ask your opinion in order to share justice, peace, and especially prosperity for global citizens. What do you think about expanding the national-based socialism into a global or international-based socialism?
The world is getting better if we could engage with more and more good people. And it might be safer word that we have if these good people are rich people and these good people are prominent political leaders. We need to have a generous rich people that share with the rest of the world, and we need peaceful leaders that struggle for peace rather than, for example, a political leader that tend to be very tyrannic and so on and so forth. Globalization brings the implication on the wider spread of ideology. And one of the consequences of globalization is the clash of ideology. I think it is part of clash of civilization as mentioned by Huntington. But it is very normal that as a human being we want to transfer and transform our belief to others. But as far as it is happened through a very peaceful way, and it is happened through a very natural way, I think we can have a more open world and we can have more perspective, because having perspective allows us to see one particular issue from many different perspectives. The problem that sometimes relate to, for example, extremism is that when we see the world only once from one single perspective, and we do not know about other perspectives. Or we just only want to use our own perspective and never ever accept other perspective. Therefore, the transformation of any ideology, whether it is capitalism, whether it is socialism, whether it is religion and so on and so forth, I think it is the consequence of global world with its very advanced information technology and heart of this movement. But as far as it is going on in the form of a very natural way, and there is no inclination or there is no attempt to dominate one over another, I think we can still have a very peaceful world. I could imagine if someone wearing a scarf and sing a song of Michael Jackson, for example. What a peaceful world, and so on. Or maybe someone that is coming from Africa and maybe can sing Balinese dance, for example. Or someone from Indonesia and sing some of Siti Nurhaliza, for example. What a peaceful world. So if you think the world with its differences as part of our treasure, as part of our richness, then we could just simply travel around the world by enjoying differences and plurality of this very rich world, culturally.